Welcome back to the program. It's good to have your company. It's 8 a.m. Our top story, SES crews are urging residents across parts of Victoria to stockpile essentials as powerful winds tear down thousands of trees and damage homes. Take a look at this map from the Victoria Emergency website. This shows more than 2,000 incidents across the state. Boy, oh boy. We have reporters tracking the extreme weather up the east coast. First to Today Melbourne reporter Isabella Stashkowski in Croydon. Izza, it's brutal out there.
It certainly is, Carl. Good morning. It's just started to become light here in Victoria and residents are coming out to see the extent of this damage. This is just one street in Victoria that has been affected. You can see this tree has fallen down and blocked off this entire street. There are about 30 homes here and it is a no-through road. So everyone here is now trapped. We've been speaking to a number of locals who just want to get out and go to work. Of course, we've been in lockdown here in Victoria as well last year and now recently. We've heard that Lilydale, just around the corner, and Emerald have been the worst affected and that Trentham is totally isolated. So scenes just like this across the entire state. Take a listen to one of those residents.
It looks like a catastrophe. I can't go to work at the moment. Been locked up for the last 6 months and I want to go earn some money. It'd be really nice.
But Carl, this morning there are some stories of locals helping each other. We met two guys just before who hadn't gone to sleep. They saw the damage on Facebook and they just wanted to go out and help their neighbours. We've also heard that police have walked on foot more than a K and a half to go help a woman and her child who were trapped inside her home. That woman became injured, of course, when trees and power lines fell on the home. Meanwhile, SES is urging people to have at least 3 days' worth of food and water. As you can see, this cleanup is likely to take a number of days, Carl.
Awful, Lizza. Thank you.
And Weatherfront is also sending a polar blast across New South Wales. Sarah Stewart is in Blackheath Forest in the Blue Mountains. Sarah, it's snowing.
It certainly is. My mission this morning was to find snow and have a look at this. We have found it in Blackheath this morning. It is snowing at the moment. It's been snowing for about 40 minutes or so. And as you can see, it's settling on the ground now. We're told there's even more snow in other areas, places like Oberon and Orange. They've had quite a lot of snow overnight. Even places like Canberra could get some more today, this afternoon. This is expected that this will hang around here for a couple of hours this morning as well. So look, last time this happened in Sydney last year, we saw lots of people coming up from Sydney. So we'll probably see that again today. But it's going to be very cold in Sydney today as well. In fact, it could be the coldest day in 25 years, a top of just 11 degrees in the city, 10 degrees in the west, and also Terry Hills as well. We know that places like Camden and Campbelltown got down to zero this morning. And look, it is very, very cold, but it's lots of fun. And I'm pretty happy that I brought the gloves and the beanie in the bag just in case this morning, Ellie.
Okay, that's it. It looks beautiful. I know it's freezing, but it really looks beautiful there this morning. Thank you, Sarah.
It's getting nasty though, isn't it? Tim Davies will have a full weather report on what's going to happen today and this evening too across the east coast. That's in about 3 or 4 minutes' time. Well, there's an urgent warning for people to come forward to testing after a Victorian woman left lockdown Melbourne and drove to Queensland, later being diagnosed with COVID-19. Our reporter Sophie Upcroft is on the Sunshine Coast. Sophie, communities up and down the coast are rightly outraged.
That's right, Carl. Three states are right now on high alert after this woman who was reported being symptomatic since last Thursday when she was travelling through New South Wales after fleeing lockdown in Melbourne and driving all the way to Queensland with her partner. Several exposure sites have been identified here in Queensland, most of them being on the Sunshine Coast where the woman has spent the last couple of days. A further 11 sites have been listed in New South Wales. Here is the mayor of Moree, one of the regional towns that has been exposed.
We're not resourced like the cities are. We don't have instant pop-up testing zones and things like that. We've got to set them all up. We've got to bring in people from away. They've got to actually physically get here. So it's an absolute dog's breakfast and we're so angry.
Extra resources are being deployed here on the Sunshine Coast today to keep up with what we are expecting to be lengthy queues as people who may have been exposed turn out to get tested. As for the five close contacts of the woman who have already been tested, we are expecting their results this morning as the Chief Health Officer and the Premier are expected to update the state at around 9 a.m. Carl?
The Mayor of Moree on the money. Sophie, thank you.
Lockdown may be lifting for Melbourne at midnight, but a number of restrictions remain in place, frustrating businesses who say they won't survive with the rules in place. The travel limit will expand from 10 to 25 kilometres with masks no longer required outdoors. Public gatherings will be limited to 10, while private gatherings remain banned. And in good news for parents, students will be allowed to return to school.
New South Wales has drawn first blood in the much-anticipated 2021 Origin Series, demolishing a lacklustre Maroons outfit 50 points to 6 in Townsville overnight. It was a dream start to the series for the Blues and debutant Brian To'o scoring two incredible tries.
Went back off Munster. Here's come through Luai. Here they go. To'o scores on debut.
Despite the thumping, Maroons fans continued the festivities late into the night, fans painting the streets in a sea of Maroon. Carl, New South Wales won 50 to 6. 50 to 6.
Just leave him alone, he's
I'm
typing.
I'm losing it.
He can hear us, I know he can.
He never had it.
Too late. You go there in your little bubble. Hey, let's cross right now to Nine's Adam Hegarty. He's right there in the thick of it. How was it? And how are you?
Yeah, I'm good. It was a bit of a different feeling here last night. We thought we had it in the bag, didn't we? But while the result clearly wasn't what we were after, the city did put on a show. We look at these pictures here. You saw them earlier as well. 27,500 fans, a touch over that. There was a bit of doubt that a region couldn't put on State of Origin 1, but they managed to. So as we've been saying all morning, why don't we say Townsville is the winner and bring on Game 2 Origin in Brisbane.
Yeah, they'll come back. It's okay, Adam, it's okay. Thanks, mate. Hey, let's check your other sport right now. And Collingwood will look to employ just their third head coach in 23 years after the club mutually agreed to part ways with current mentor Nathan Buckley yesterday. Despite stellar results over his decade with the Pies, Buckley never won a premiership with the club, falling so agonisingly short in 2018 against the West Coast Eagles. Weather time now at Tim. G'day.
Alex, good morning. We still have a damaging wind warning in place for parts of Victoria. Boy, oh boy, hasn't it been a wild night? Some of the pictures that Izzo showed us from Croydon just a few minutes ago, we have seen winds in excess of 60 kilometres and 120 kilometres in some elevated parts of Victoria and also northeastern parts of Tasmania as well. Now, take a look at the rainfall that's come with that too. You can see from this graphic the red whoosh essentially just over parts of Victoria, over Melbourne last night, staggering just to see how much damage has been done. Also with the cold air that is associated with this cold weather system that is moving right up and down our eastern seaboard, we're seeing a lot of heavy precipitation with that. That is why we're seeing snowfall right up into the Darling Downs area of Queensland as well. Central New South Wales getting a real touch up this morning as well with this wet and cold weather. We've got lots of frost and snow falling in some parts around Orange today as well. It's going to be another chilly one. But yeah, just staggering to see some of the damage that has been caused overnight with the wind and the rain from this system. Let's see what is going to happen with your forecast in our major capitals today. Cairns, you're expecting sunny conditions, a top of 25, really the place to be. 19 degrees for Brisbane after a very chilly start, right down into the single digits, 19 the top. 11 will be the high for Sydney. It will feel much colder though with the showers. Showers also for Canberra, heading for a high of 10. Windy still throughout Melbourne throughout the day. Rain will ease though, 16 will be the top. Rain also for Hobart today, 13 degrees. Adelaide, partly cloudy and 17. 21 with some showers for Perth. Alice Springs, some morning frost, mostly sunny, 15. And Darwin, sunshine and 31 degrees. We will stay across that damaging wind warning that is still current for Victoria. But we are waking up this morning at Rockley State School as I go back to school this week. Lovely to be here this morning with the principal, Julia Bailey, and the kids. They do something called Wheels on Wednesday. Let's sit these little ones off. All right, guys, are we ready to go? Nice, safe riding, please. 3, 2, 1, off you go. Take us around the track. Wheels on Wednesday. Wednesday on a Thursday, just because we're here. Tell us, Julie, what is it?
So every Wednesday, the children are invited to bring their bikes to school. And at playtime, both breaks, they get to ride their bikes around the school. They create a track and they decide where they're going to go and what they're going to do during
that playtime. Great to learn all about road safety, riding safety, all that sort of stuff. Where are all your apps, all these other schools I'm going to have got all this technology. Where are all yours?
Yeah, we love technology, but kids get a lot of technology at home.
Yeah.
So while we're at school, we like to get our kids outdoors, and Wheels on Wednesday is the perfect way to allow that to happen.
Oh, well, the kids certainly love it. I'm going to jump on a bike and go for a quick ride as well, guys. We'll see you with more from Rockley State School here in Brisbane. Brisbane's smallest school very soon.
What a great school, though. Thank you, Tim. Well, we want you to take a look at this picture. It is absolutely beautiful. This was new mum, Sarah Hayter, last night, cradling her son, Ilias, for the very first time at the Royal Brisbane and Women's Hospital.
It has been quite the journey. Sarah and husband Mo had recently returned from living and working in Qatar and were just going into quarantine when Sarah was rushed to hospital. Her son delivered 10 weeks early. And, of course, the strict quarantine rules meant that until last night, Sarah was not allowed to visit or to hold her new son. Let's have another look at that photo. That's how much it meant, huh?
Aww.
There you go. Well, Mo and Sarah join us now from Brisbane. Sarah, good morning to you. Gee, it's been a tough time for you. Can you describe that moment for us last night?
Good morning. It was nerve-wracking. It was one of the most amazing moments of my life. I immediately cried. He's just very, very small and tiny. It breaks my heart.
And so how long was it between you actually giving birth, because we know that he was rushed off straight away, you didn't get to hold him, to when you actually got to see him last night like that and to touch him?
Well, from June 1st she delivered and until yesterday night, I think that's 8 days.
Yes, 8 days.
Yeah.
Mo, were you allowed to also do the same thing, or is that not allowed at this point?
So I was with her last night. So I ended up joining her for quarantine. She needed help getting out of bed, all the things a nurse should be helping her with, and then our quarantine both finished at 5:40. There was a bit of a process to get out, and then we went straight there.
So what was it like for you then, as well, to be there?
It was nerve-wracking. I still feel nervous now. I think not happening naturally kind of left a bit of a sour taste with the whole experience, but that's our son. We love him unconditionally, and we're there to fight for him as parents, and that's what we've been doing the past week.
Mm.
And just give us an idea of what the last few days and weeks have been like, because you arrived in quarantine, he was born 10 weeks early, you've both tested negative 4 times to COVID, you've both been fully vaccinated, but, I mean, Sarah, you had to deliver him alone. Mo, you weren't allowed to be with her. How has this whole process been for you both?
It's been like torture. It's been eating us alive.
I say it's a nightmare. I would say it shouldn't happen to anyone.
No.
Like you said, we're fully vaccinated. The whole country's being pushed to jump on vaccines, and I guess this was the perfect situation to show you what a vaccine counts for. And for us, it counts for nothing. But for others, it means they can go on trips to Tokyo. So it just puts the hypocrisy and the double standards in plain view at this point.
Sarah,
so what is allowed and what isn't allowed.
Sarah, you were alone for some of that during deeply emotional and painful periods. How did you get through and what was it like to navigate for you emotionally?
I had phone calls from my husband every day, my family. I was trying to keep up. Expressing Milk was helping me. I just imagined that my son was with me, and that was actually getting me through it. But
it's tough, isn't it? It's tough. You know, this is
yes, it is. It's very tough. This is something I've always wanted, you know, I've always dreamt of, you know, having him right on me when I deliver him. But that got taken away from me, and I have to live with that for the rest of my life, with my first newborn.
Oh, I love
it. It's just not right.
It's not how it should be, is it? And I know that Queensland Health wouldn't give you an exemption to see him, to Mo, to let you be in the hospital. I know you offered to both wear hazmat suits. I know the hospital was on board. They said they could make it happen. Mm-hmm. But we're now at this point, you've still got a long road ahead, don't you? You're now seeking help to be airlifted home to Melbourne. Can you tell us what you need now?
Exactly. I need my family, their support. I feel weird being in this state without my family.
And also, like you said, we reached out to Queensland Health to help us to airlift Ilias. They just directed us to the hospital, who were informed it'll cost $30,000. So to come up with that sum is, I don't know how it's going to happen. We're just hoping sponsors, a crowdfund or something happens to get the ball rolling at least while we continue to seek help in that regards.
Okay, it's a tough road that you've been down, and some tough days ahead and weeks ahead, but we wish you all the very best. If you would like to help Mo and Sarah out, please get in touch via our email or social media pages, and we'll do our best for them as well. Good on you guys. Thank you so much for being with
us.
Thank you,
guys. Thank you. Let's just take another little look at that photo of little Ilias and holding the hand of his mum, Sarah. Our hearts and best wishes go out to that beautiful family. Stay with us. We'll be back in a tick.